Hello students, so now in this module we are going to discuss the beta particle spectra, gamma decay and some other processes like internal pair creation and internal conversion. So in the beta particle spectra, we had already discussed about the beta decays, that were the electron emission, positron emission and the electron capture. So let us study about the beta particle decay, how this happened. So if we suppose that we have a parent nucleus, that is ZXA, which is in its initial state and in the state of rest, it disintegrates to form a daughter nucleus and an electron. So the daughter nucleus is recoiling, so it is called the recoil nucleus, and the electron is also in a moving state. For the conservation of momentum, here we have shown that they both move in the opposite direction. So this is the final state, that is the daughter nucleus that is formed, and this is the electron. So what they saw, that the initial state of the parent atom was at rest. Since the nucleus are quite massive in nature, they are quite heavy, so the heavy particle will have least velocity. Those who's having a high mass will have lower velocity. So if a particle or if a nucleus is very heavy, having low velocity, how much kinetic energy will it possess? It will possess practically negligible kinetic energy, or we can say it will have zero kinetic energy. So the kinetic energy possessed by the daughter nucleus will be approximately zero. So the whole kinetic energy will be transferred to the electron. So, and we have also discussed that there is a Q value of the reaction. Since the kinetic energy of the daughter nucleus is zero, so the Q value of the equation will be possessed by the electrons. So the kinetic energy must be equal to the Q value of the reaction. But they had shown that if we plot a graph between the relative number of electrons and the kinetic energies possessed by the electrons, so we see that the maximum number of electrons are possessing least kinetic energy, and the number of electrons which is possessing highest kinetic energy is very less. So we see that the highest kinetic energy is found by very small number of electrons. So, and it was also found that the maximum value of the kinetic energy that was possessed by the electron was not equal to the Q value of the reaction. It was quite less than the Q value of the reaction. So if the kinetic energy is less than the Q value of the reaction, so who is carrying the excess energy? Extra energy is carried by what particle? There is no other particle which could carry the excess Q value of the reaction. So a point came, there was some searches done, that who is carrying this missing energy. So in 1931, Pauli proposed a model where he said that the parent nucleus not only disintegrates into a daughter nucleus and an electron, but an additional particle that is called the antineutrino was also eliminated or also emitted out. So he suggested that this antineutrino particle is not interacting with matter. Its interaction with the matter is extremely low. It has no interaction with the matter. But the properties were that it is having zero charge, it carries zero rest mass, and the intrinsic spin of the antineutrino is half integral. So due to the zero charge of the reaction, the atomic number was conserved. Since there is Z atomic charge here it is Z plus 1, here minus 1. So on the right hand side the charge is Z. So the atomic charges are conserved by the addition of the antineutrino. Since the mass, rest mass is also nearly zero, so the mass numbers were also conserved. So the conservation of atomic number and atomic masses came into there, and conservation of charge was also conserved. So intrinsic spin was half. This intrinsic spin could satisfy the conservation of angular momentum. For example, if we suppose that the parent nucleus here consists of even number of nucleons. Since even number of nucleons are said to possess an integral spin, either it will possess zero spin, that the nucleons will pair off and cancel each other to give a zero spin, or it would add up to give a integral spin. So the spin on the reactant side, that is the parent nucleus, will have an integral spin. Now if we see the spin on the right hand side, so the daughter nucleus is also assuming the A number of nucleons, because both the daughter and the parent are isobars of each other. So since A is here even and it is having integral spin, so the daughter nucleus will also have an integral spin. But since the electron is a fermion particle, it will possess a half integral spin. And we have also seen that the intrinsic spin of the antineutrino is half. So either both the spins of the electron and the neutrinos will add up to give an integral spin, that is one, or both will cancel up to give a half plus spin and minus spin to give a value of zero, which will also be integral spin. So we can see that on the left hand side the spin was integral, and on the right hand side also the total spin of the reaction is coming to be integral. So in this way the spin was conserved as well as the angular momentum was conserved, where the angular momentum is also a multiple of h cross, that is spin. So we see that the conservation of angular momentum, conservation of spin took place with the discovery of the antineutrinos. So this antineutrino was the particle behind the missing energy term. So the extra energy which the electron could not carry with itself, that energy was carried by the antineutrino particle, which justified the answer of the missing energy. So this theory was very well taken by each and every one, and it was given that a parent atom decays in the beta minus decay as it gives a product nucleus, daughter nucleus, electron, and a antineutrino is also associated with it. Similarly, when there is a beta positive decay, when we have a beta positive decay, so here it will be plus 1 and the Z will be replaced by Z minus 1, and the antineutrino particle will be replaced by neutrino. So a neutrino and antineutrinos are attached, associated with the electrons and positrons. So in the positron decay we have neutrino associated with it, whereas in the case of electron emission there is an antineutrino associated with it, and both the neutrinos and antineutrinos have similar properties. Both have zero charge, both have zero rest mass, and both have intrinsic spin of half, that is they are the fermions. And it is found that the neutrinos have a mass of 5 into 10 raised to power minus 4 times the mass of the rest mass of the electron or a positron. So they are quite lighter than the electrons and positrons. So they are called, regarded as the light particles, where they are having a mass of comparison of 1 by 10,000 times of the mass of the electron. So if we see the beta decays, so we can say, interpret here, that the neutron changes into a proton and an electron and an antineutrino. And this decay scheme is called the beta minus decay. Whereas in the beta plus decay, a proton turns into a neutron and a positron and a neutrino is associated with it. And in the third reaction, that was for the electron capture, again a proton is changing into a neutron, but here electron is being captured by a proton to give out a neutron and a neutrino. So whenever we have to associate a neutrino, there is a positron with its on its side, and antineutrino is always attached to the electron. So if we take this neutrino to this side, so the neutrino will be changed to antineutrino, and if we change this neutrino to this side, it would be antineutrino here. So in this way we have to always associate a neutrino with a positron and an antineutrino with an electron. So The points of difference between the neutrino and antineutrino are, although both have zero charge, zero rest mass, and both have half spins, but the difference in the neutrino and antineutrino is the how their spins are oriented with respect to the angular momentum. So the particle, the neutrino is that particle with spin vector parallel to the momentum vector, and antineutrino is a particle which is having a spin anti-parallel to the momentum vector. So it acts like a right-handed screw if we curl the fingers of our right hand. So the fingers are curling this way. Similarly, this direction is shown as the anti-clockwise direction. So the neutrino has a spin anti-clockwise or as a right-handed screw. And similarly, if we curl the fingers of the left hand, so you can see that the fingers is curling this way. So the direction is clockwise. So the antineutrino particle acts like a left-handed screw, or its direction is clockwise direction. So these were the something related to neutrinos and antineutrinos. And for the beta decay process, the missing energy was carried by the neutrinos and the antineutrino particle. So next we come to the gamma decay. So here we have illustrated some nuclear energy levels of the radioactive thallium-208. This is the ground state energy of thallium. This is the higher energy states, and this is the highest excited state of the thallium. So whenever the excited nucleus, takes a transition from its excited state to a ground state, so we say that some release of energy will be there, and this release of energy will be accompanied by the gamma rays. So gamma rays will be liberated whenever an excited nucleus makes a transition from higher excited state to a lower excited state. And the energy that will be involved in the reaction will be equal to the difference of the two energy states. So if supposingly here a gamma ray is liberated from the energy state where the transition takes place from 0.472 mega electron volt to zero state, so a gamma ray equivalent to 0.472 mega electron volt will be liberated. If supposingly a gamma ray is liberated when the transition takes place from 0.327 mega electron volt to zero mega electron volt state, so gamma ray of 0.327 mega electron volt will take place. Supposingly that the transition takes place from 0.327, or you can say it takes place from 0.327 to 0.04. So gamma will be liberated of the energy of 0.327 minus 0.04 mega electron volt. So the difference between the two energy levels is the value of the gamma rays that it carries energy along with it. So this is the gamma decay. So we can show here that the gamma decay process can be written as that ZXA star is coming out to the down state, that is the ground state, liberating a gamma ray, where the gamma ray is having energy equivalent to h nu, and this h nu will be equal to the difference in the energy level, that is E2 minus E1. So the gamma rays will be having energy of difference of the two energy states, that is E2 minus E1. And if this is the energy h nu, so we can write the momentum. So momentum is given by h nu by c, and h nu by c will be equal to the momentum, that is mv. So from this equation, h nu by c equal to mv, we can calculate any of the parameter that we require to be calculated for the gamma ray. So this is the reaction where the gamma rays or gamma decay is taking place, that the excited atom, parent atom, is decaying into a ground state, daughter nucleus, and then the same element remains the same, where it can be said that the atom or the nucleus is coming from a higher excited state to a lower excited state, and there is a liberation of gamma rays. So this was the decay scheme of the gamma rays. So similarly, now we come to the internal conversion. So what happens in the internal conversion? So as we see that the nucleus was coming from the higher excited state to the lower excited state. So when the nucleus is coming from the higher excited state to the lower excited state, what happens? It happens so that the nucleus, we know that this is the nucleus and these are the surrounding orbits of the nucleus where many electrons are present in the orbits. So somehow when the nucleus makes a transition from higher excited state to a lower excited state, energy is released. So when this energy is sufficient enough to knock down or liberate a bound electron from its orbit, then we say that the internal conversion takes place. Means that the energy which would have been imparted to gamma rays, that the gamma rays would be liberated, those gamma rays energies are sufficient enough to liberate, to knock off a bound electron from its bounded state or from the bounded orbits. So that is called the internal conversion. So here ZXA star means the nucleus in the excited state is coming to the ground state, but it is imparting its energy to the electron, not to the gamma rays. So it is imparting its electron to the surrounding electrons, and the ejection of the atomic electron takes place, and these atomic electrons in the orbit are called as the conversation electrons. So the ejection of the conversation electrons takes place from its bound orbit. So this is the internal conversion. Means the internal conversion names come from the fact that there is something internally converted which converted the rays, energy of the gamma ray, into the energy of the electron. The energy was transferred to the electron to knock it out from the orbit. So the conversion of the ejection of the conversation electron from the bound orbit takes place. So what will be the kinetic energy of the ejected electrons? So what will be the kinetic energy of this ejected electron? So this kinetic energy will be definitely equal to the difference in the two levels, that is E2 minus E1. And from this energy, something must have been imparted to overcome its binding forces. So E2 minus E1 minus its binding energy is the resultant kinetic energy of the electron that it would carry with it when it goes out of the atom. So the kinetic energy of the ejected electron is nothing but E2 minus E1 minus the binding energy of the orbital electron. So as the gamma rays are internally converted, as some phenomena internally happened, that the energy of the gamma ray has been used to knock off the orbital electron. So that is why this process is called the internal conversion. So the lowest energy, since the innermost shell is the K shell, then it comes the L shell, then comes the M shell or the M orbit. So the lowest energy that is required to remove the K shell, K orbit electron, is given by E lowest is equal to E2 minus E1 minus EK, because it is Kth orbit is the innermost orbit closest to the nucleus. So it will have the lowest energy. So E lowest will be E2 minus E1 minus EK. As it is very close to the nucleus, so more energy will be required to knock it off. There is more interactive bonding between the innermost electron and the nucleus. So we have to provide maximum energy, and the kinetic energy that will be possessed by this K orbit would be the lowest. Whereas the orbits which are moving away from the nucleus are not having tight interaction with the nucleus, and so it is easy to knock off the outermost orbit electrons. So that is why the kinetic energy possessed by the kth orbital electron will be the lowest. So E lowest is E2 minus E1 minus EK. And subsequently we can write the value of the kinetic energy for other shells, which will be given by E2 minus E1 minus EL or EM, EN and so on. So this was how we can calculate the kinetic energies of the orbital electron from which orbit they are being striked off. So if you want to calculate the decay constant, so the decay constant will be given by So the decay constant will be given by lambda will be lambda E plus lambda gamma. Why lambda E plus lambda gamma? Because there are ways in which either gamma rays could be produced when the transition is taking place, or there could be an electron emission also. That is the internal conversion. So the gamma decay constant lambda will be the sum of the decay constant of the due to the electron conversion or due to the gamma decay. So the total transition probability will be given by lambda E plus lambda gamma. And if we want to calculate the conversion coefficient, so the conversion coefficient is given by alpha, which is means that how many gamma rays has been converted to produce the orbital electrons, to knock off the orbital electrons. So alpha is equal to ne upon n gamma, means number of electrons upon number of gamma rays. Means how many gammas are used to knock off the orbital electrons from its orbit, bound orbits. So this is equivalent to lambda e upon lambda gamma. So conversion coefficient alpha is equal to ne upon n gamma, or it is equal to lambda e upon lambda gamma. So what we say, alpha is equal to ne upon n gamma, which is equal to the decay constant of electron upon decay constant due to the gamma ray emission. So since the electrons could be from the K shell, L shell, M shell, so we can write as lambda K plus lambda L plus lambda M upon lambda gamma. So this can be separately written as lambda K upon lambda gamma plus lambda L upon lambda gamma plus lambda M upon lambda gamma. So lambda K upon lambda gamma is nothing but alpha K, that is the conversion coefficient of the K orbital, and this will be alpha L, this will be alpha M. So the conversion coefficient can be regarded as the sum of the conversion coefficient due to the different orbits. So alpha is equal to alpha K plus alpha L plus alpha M. So this was all in your internal conversion. So in the gamma decay, what we saw that when the nucleus from the excited state comes to the ground state, the difference in the energy will be the resultant that it would impart a gamma ray of the energy equivalent to the difference of energy. And in internal conversion, what happened that when the nucleus is coming from the excited to the ground state, instead of producing gamma rays, the energy is sufficient enough. It is more than the energy of the binding energy of the electron in its orbit, that it knocks out the electron from its ground state. So this is the internal conversion. And next we come to the internal pair creation. Now what happens? That when the gamma rays are produced, see here, when the nucleus had come from the excited state to the ground state, here some gamma rays were produced. But if this gamma ray energy, the transition energy E gamma, is greater than 2m0c square, when this transition energy is greater than E gamma, is greater than 2m0c square, where m0 is the rest mass of the electron, so when it is greater than 2m0c square, so E gamma takes a value of 1.022 mega electron volt. So I mean to say that when the transition energy, that the gamma ray possesses an energy greater than 1.02 mega electron volt, then it is capable of producing an electron and positron pair. Here what it did, that the gamma rays had knocked out the atomic electron, okay, from the bound states. But here if the energy exceeds 1.02 mega electron volt, it is capable of enough to create an electron and positron pair. So an excited nucleus may emit an electron and positron pair. And this was suggested in 1933 by Oppenheimer and Nedelsky. So Oppenheimer and Nedelsky in 1933 proposed that when the transition energy of the gamma ray is E gamma is greater than 2m0c square, or it is greater than 1.022 mega electron volt, then it is self capable to produce an electron and positron pair. And this can take place anywhere in the Coulomb field, wherever it is there, it can take place, electron pair creation can take place, and the momentum is also conserved between the nucleus and the electron positron pair. So friends, so students, I hope that I am able to make you understand the concept of the beta spectra, gamma decay and the internal pair creation and the internal conversion. Thank you.